Hi everyone, welcome to this seminar on machine learning and meaningful games. So today it's our great pleasure to have Fabio Camilli from Università di Roma, La Sapienza. Thank you very much for accepting the invitation, Fabio, to give this talk. So Fabio is going to talk about meaningful games approach to cluster analysis. Thank you again, and well, the floor is yours.
Thank you for inviting me to give this talk and this online series of seminars about meaningful games and machine learning. So the result I will present are obtained in collaboration with Laura Aquilanti and Raul De Maio, who are my former PhD student, and Simone Cacace from the University of Rome La Sapienza, and Adriano Fessa from Politecnico of Torino. Okay, let me first recall how I started this line of research. So I was looking for a topic to give to one of my PhD students. I would like to give something about meaningful games and machine learning. And looking on the web, I found this, the slides of the talk that Pierre Lulions gave in the Huawei technology, Huawei company. So he made the presentation of the theory of meaningful games, also discussed some possible application. And one of these applications was exactly to cluster analysis. So in the slides, there is also a simple model starting from the model by Pierre Lulions, then we developed the theory, so we get some new results. If it is possible, still possible to find these slides on the web, but if you want, I can send you, I can send to Mathieu, but they are available on the web. So, so this is one of the pages, you can see the clustering model and came in expectation maximization. So essentially we developed this idea my talk. So let me recall first which is the difference from unsupervised. So cluster analysis is a classic argument in unsupervised machine learning. The difference between unsupervised and supervised machine learning is that in supervised machine learning we have some point in input and at this point we also know the output. Using these points, this data set, we can train an algorithm, so to define a function in such a way to get the best relationship between input and output data, and then use this function, this algorithm for other problems. In unsupervised machine learning, we have only data, so we don't have labeled data, but we have this data, and the aim is to find some structure, some information that we can extract from this data. Okay, in particular, one of the most interesting problem in unsupervised machine learning is the cluster analysis. In cluster analysis, we have this data, and we want to regroup the data in some classes in such a way that the data inside the same class are much more similar than from the other classes. The way we create, because define this class depends on what we want to find. For example, we can consider shape, color, or also a combination of various information. So you see here in these two applications. Typical application of cluster analysis, as I told, this is typical of unsupervised machine learning, find patterns in a data set, or also to pre-process sample data for other algorithms and supervised machine learning. For example, before applying an expensive algorithm for face recognition, before applying this algorithm, supervised, we can regroup the data, the face in a homogeneous group and apply the algorithm only to a subset of the data. Another classical application at this color quantization, when we want to reduce the number of the colors in a picture, in images, in order to when we want to store this image, we can save memory, so we want to reduce the number of colors, but retaining some information about the original picture. Other interesting application, all the class algorithm are used, for example, by online company selling online as Amazon, eBay. They want to group, divide custom in homogeneous group in order to have, for example, specific advertising for some people in which are similar characteristics. Also in astronomy, grouping different stars, we can find objects which are not in any of these groups, so are probably interesting objects. Also in the study of DNA, it is interesting to regroup genes which are similar property, but since probably they have also similar function. So classical algorithm in broadly speaking, we can say that the algorithms in cluster analysis can be divided into classes. In R clustering, each data point belongs only to a single class, as you see in the imagine in the left side. So we can define a data point belongs exactly to one class. It is a hard clustering. In soft clustering, we give some probability, some degree of a point for a point to belong to a given class. So you can see, for example, if here we are considering shape and color. So shape green or either green or blue, or color circular or hexagonal. So this point is with a high probability, with a high degree in this cluster, while this point, which is circular but or light blue, is almost the same probability to belong to one of the two classes. So our class, sub cluster are these different algorithms. And I will short review two famous, well-known, so famous also, old algorithm for this type of problem. I will consider the classical K-means problem for R clustering, also the corresponding Lloyd algorithm to solve the K-means problem. And for soft clustering, I will consider a mixture model and the expectation maximization algorithm. I will recall this to model these two algorithms, since I will present an analogous by means of mean field gain theory of this type of algorithm. So it is better to recall the classical algorithms. R clustering via k-means. We have a finite data set, a finite number of points in Euclidean space, so the cardinality of finite cardinality. And we want to subdivide this point in capital K class. Capital K is fixed a priori. In cluster analysis, the number of classes in which we want to subdivide the data is fixed a priori. This is an important characteristic. How we can divide this point? We consider this K-means functional. The K-means functional depends on two variables. The variable C, which is the cluster assignment, which so a point I belongs to the cluster K if and only if the distance of the point xi from the barycenter mu k is minimal with respect to the distance from all the other barycenter, mu j assay the barycenter. And also, so the other variable are the cluster barycenter, which are given by mu1, mu k, so the barycenter of the classes. By minimizing this functional, we subdivide the data set in capital K clusters, where a point belongs to the one cluster of barycenter mu k, if the distance from the barycenter is minimal with respect to all the other distances. So in this way, an observation belongs exactly to one class. to solve this problem, it is typical to use the Lloyd algorithm. By the Lloyd algorithm, we start for an arbitrary initial assignment on the barycenter or vector of barycenter. And if we know the barycenter at the iteration n, then we use two steps. In the first step, we consider a cluster assignment. So we assign a point to the closest barycenter at barycenter the step n. So this is the cluster assignment of the point xi. Then, computed in the new cluster assignment, we update the barycenter. We compute the new barycenter by means of this formula. We iterate this iteration until the difference between two iterations becomes small. Typically, it is possible to prove that for a finite number of points, this algorithm converges after a finite number of iterations. Let me show how this method works in practice. So we have this data set of points. We can see clearly that there are two clusters in this data set. The data set is the picture A. In picture B, we assign two arbitrary barycenter. In C, we assign the point to the closest barycenter. So we subdivide this data set in two classes, red for the point close to the barycenter, red cross, and blue for the point closer to the blue cross. In the following step, we update the barycenter. So you see that the barycenter move to the new barycenter, and we iterate. After a finite number of iteration, we get this configuration. So we have set by the data set into two clusters. Okay, which are the pros and cons of this method? It is very fast and also very simple to implement on a computer, since we need only to compute distance of point from barycenter. It's so very simple to implement. Some problem are the k-means functional is not convex, so we can have several minima, also local minima. So in general, the algorithm converges to local minima, not to the global minima. Also, the number of clusters is selected a priori, but this is common for almost all the algorithm in cluster analysis. And the other problem, since we are minimizing the distance function, the clusters are in any case circular. So this can be well suited for some particular configuration, but not for other configuration. You can see in these three examples clearly the algorithm is not able to catch the correct clusterization of the dataset. So this was the k-means and the Lloyd algorithm. And for soft clustering, we consider this finite mixture model. In finite mixture model, we consider the dataset as the samples of a random variable. A random variable which can be continuous, so continuous assume the random variable assume values in some Euclidean space, also discrete, so the random variable takes values in a finite set, for example, 0 and 1 for Bernoulli random variable. And we want to describe by means of the dataset or the point of the dataset to find a probability which gives the best representation of this dataset in terms of distribution. We consider a particular form for the probability representing the dataset, which is a convex combination. This convex combination parameterizes probability density function. So alpha k are the weights, so satisfy this condition, where pk are parameterized probability density function, where theta k is a parameter which depends on the problem. For example, classical choices are Gaussian distribution in this case. So the component on the convex combination are Gaussian probability density function. In this case, the parameters are given by mean and covariance, where if the random variable takes only 0, 1 values, so we have a discrete sample space, you can consider the Bernoulli distribution or more general categorical distribution if the number of points is the number of values is some values, say capital S. In this case, for Bernoulli distribution, the parameter is described by the Bernoulli parameter. Why Mr. Model are important? So there is large literature about this Mr. Model. Consider the same dataset of the K-means algorithm. So I want to represent in some sense this dataset as the sample point of a random variable. If we consider a single Gaussian function, clearly a single distribution is not able to catch the fact that we have two groups of dataset well distinct, well separate. So the single Gaussian put most of the mass of the measure in the center where we don't have almost any points. If we instead we consider a convex combination to Gaussian function, so we can put the mass of the two components of the combination in the baricenter of the two clusters. So convex combination give much better representation of some data set in general. We have more parameters to use to give to represent the data set. Okay, so we want to find this probability density function in such a way that give the best representation possible of the dataset. And this can be done by maximizing the classical log-likelihood functional with respect to the weights alpha to the parameter theta, which depends on the choice of the density function, parameterized density function. Okay, to compute the maximum of this function, we use the expectation maximization. I will describe the next slide. In this log-likelihood function, there is this quantity which are called responsibilities. This is very important since it represents the probability in formal way, not exactly, but more or less the sense is this one, represent the probability that a point X I has been generated by the component K of the mixture. So we can assign the point to the cluster for which the probability of being, for which the responsibility is maximal. So for which the probability that has been generated by the component K is maximal. It is very important in this type of problem. Okay, to compute the maximum of the log-likelihood algorithm, we use this expectation maximization algorithm. In the Gaussian case, it's particularly nice since we have explicit expression for the value of the parameter we have to compute. In general, it's not so simple to write, but it works in any case. So in the expectation, we start from arbitrary assignment of the initial parameter, so the weights, the mean and the covariance matrix, and at the iteration end, we, given the parameter at the previous step, we compute, thanks to the Bayes theorem, so we compute the responsibility, and in this case, the formula can be, we have an explicit formula, thanks to the Bayes theorem. Once we have the responsibility, again, by using the fact that we have Gaussian random variable, we can update the parameter, alpha, mu, baricenter, and covariance metric. We iterate these two steps until a certain tolerance condition is reached. Also, in this case, the log-likelihood maximal is not concave, so the algorithm can converge to local maxima, not necessarily to the optimal maxima. This we have the same data set in the mixture model with two components. So this represents the level set of the initial distribution. For simplicity, we can take the covariance matrix, the identity. So these are the levels, one level set of the initial distribution of the Gaussian function. We compute the responsibility, so you can see that we assign to each data point the probability, so that the point has been generated by the blue, either blue or the red random variable. You can see in the, while the point close to the one or two random variables as a red or blue, the point in the middle are violet, so they have almost the same probability of being generated by one of the two random variables. So we, in this way we compute the responsibility, we update the parameters, so we update the mean and the covariance, and okay, we iterate, we compute again the responsibility, and so on. So this way until reaching some configuration, and this is the final configuration. We have a convex combination of these two Gaussian variables with some appropriate weights. Okay, clearly this method is more flexible in terms with respect to k-means, since we have more parameters that we can optimize. Also, the cluster are not necessarily circular, because of the covariance matrix, we can take also ellipsoidal shape. So you can see in this picture, this is a classical data set which is available on the web. Usually it is used to test the algorithm. And these are the points. So this point should be all of the same color. So are in different color, just to see that this was distinguish the different part of the mouse head. So this is the clusterization given by the k-means, and you can see that it's not exact, since part of the point in the head of the mouse associated to the one of the two here. And we said that this is the clusterization by the mixture model, computed by means of the expectation maximization algorithm. So it's much better than the previous clusterization. The disadvantages are similar also in this case, since similar to the one for the k-means model. One of the problems that we have to fix a priori the number of clusters. In this case, it's very simple to see that there are three groups of points, but in general, if the number of the data is very large, it's not easy to guess which is the correct number of the cluster we want to use. Also, since the log likelihood max function is not concave, we starting from different initial point, we can get different result. And also in this case, since the cluster are a little rigid, in any case they are ellipsoidal, they fail on some particular example. For example, typically for this type of example, also in the middle, the mixture model is not appropriate. Okay. So these are some basic reference for cluster analysis. In particular, I want to point out this book, a very nice book where most of the classical methods, all these methods are very old. So it goes back to the before the 2000, so before, say, also in the 80s, 90s of the previous century. And in this nice book, there is an interesting view of all the algorithms. And these are more specific, for example, this one for the M algorithm, the expectation maximization algorithm, this is for the k-means, and this is a recent review of various clustering techniques. So there are many clustering algorithms, in this paper by Saxena Brasar, Gupta, etc., you find a review of several algorithms in this for cluster analysis. Now I want to describe the model which we obtained by means of mean-field game theory. I just recall very briefly mean-field game theory, so probably since this is a seminar about the relation between mean-field game and machine learning, I assume that most of the people know the basic of mean-field game theory. So, mean-field game theory is a model to study interaction among a large number of agents which are rational, small, homogeneous, identical. Each agent is described by a stochastic differential equation. So this is the equation for the representative agent. And we can choose different functional. For example, this ergodic cost functional. Lxa is the Lagrangian, which represents the cost of the single agent, and capital F is the coupling cost, so a cost which depends on the state of the agent, but also on this distribution M of all the other agents. The function M represents the distribution of the agent, of the state of the agent. Nash equilibrium of this case is an ergodic mean field game, so we have this mean field game system stationary. It is described in some way the Nash equilibrium for the previous differential game. So the unknown are the first equation, Hamilton, Jacobi, Bellman equation, and the unknown are the couple U lambda. Lambda is the value function, U is also called the corrector. The second equation is a Fokker-Planck equation, the solution is given by the distribution. And the coupling is in the first and the second equation. These are normalization conditions. Okay, this is the most simple model since the cost of the agent is separate from the cost of the single agent. So the cost of the coupling cost is separate from the cost of the single agent. A very short recall on mean-field game theory. So now we discuss our approach to cluster analysis. We consider that our dataset is so big that it's better described by density function. So we consider function F, which is a probability density function, which describe in some way our dataset. It's better to describe by function more since the dataset is so big. And the idea is that we want to find the convex combination of probability density function mu k, which gives the best representation of the dataset. Okay, the idea, this was in the slides of Birgilions, is to consider data points as agents. So data points now are rational agents, and we have an initial population represented in some way from the dataset that we want to subdivide in k population. And this will be obtained by means of multi-population mean-field games model. And the crucial point is the cost functional for the optimal control problem solved by the single agent, since in this cost functional, in some way, we have to encode the similarity among the agents. So recall that we want to regroup the agent in such a way that the object agent of data in the same class are much more similar than agent from another class. So the crucial point is to define a appropriate cost function. Just an important remark, this is a non-standard multi-population mean-field games model, since in the classical multi-population model, the population are well subdivided from the beginning, so the population are subdivided they interact by means of some coupling costs among the population. In this case, the problem is different. We start from an undistinguished population and we want to subdivide in k subpopulations. So it's not exactly a multi-population midfield game model as in the classical theory. Okay, this is the model. We assume that the single agent, now data are agent, follows a stochastic, standard stochastic differential equation where A is the control, and this is our cost functional. So the cost functional is ergodic cost functional, but it is possible to consider also other cost functional. It's composed of two parts, a quadratic part, depending on the control, which is classical as a regularizing effect, and the coupling cost. The coupling cost is this quadratic function which penalizes. Okay, let me, I will show. So here, mu k are the barycenter of the population of the data set. So it's the f is the distribution of the data points. Gamma k is are the responsibility, so the fraction of the mass of the k population on the total mass. And so this way we compute the barycenter of the fraction of the population which is assigned to the cluster k. It's similar for the covariance. And these are the weights. So this, you see that the weights are exactly the fraction of the data point which are assigned to the population k. Okay, you see this, the function is... Yes.
Sorry to interrupt. Can I ask a short question?
Yes, yes.
Okay, sorry. So here, just to make sure I understand, so xk is a state of one representative agent, yes, in population k.
Yes.
And this is in the same space as the data points, right? It represents, yes, maybe the position of the data point. Or,
yes, exactly.
But the data points are not supposed to move, right? Usually it is the centers that are going to move. But here you kind of change the point of view.
No, it is essentially, this is a stationary midfield game model. So we found the agents doesn't move, but they want to find an optimal configuration in some sense, which is represented by the invariant measure associated to each agent. So it's
okay.
So it is stationary. So it moves, but at the end, when the time tends to the infinite, they go to the optimal configuration, as also for the classical stationary problem. So it's formal to say that they move. So, but we take in any case the limit as it tends to infinity. So this is the configuration at the final time.
Okay. But when t goes to infinity, maybe each xk is still moving around, but the distribution is not moving anymore.
Yeah.
Something like this.
Yes.
And what matters is the distribution.
Yes.
And so here, okay. And so here in the barycenter formulation, for example, so f, the function f is fixed because this is a data set.
Yes, exactly.
And what is going to change is the gamma k. Right. Okay.
Gamma k is the crucial, since gamma k is not known at this level. We know when we solve the midfield game system, we know gamma k, which is essentially the probability that a point is assigned to the cluster k. The point in the state x is assigned to the cluster k. So mu k, we can explicitly write mu k in my kind of k, but they are not known if we don't solve. They are known when we solve the system, since we have to compute m k and m the final configuration. So
okay,
we prove the existence by a fixed point essentially. So it's okay, I will try. I also say this one. The cost functional forces the point to stay closer to the bycenter, which minimizes the distance. So if sigma, capital sigma, is the identity, this is exactly the square of the distance from the bycenter. So the cost functional forces the point to stay to the close to the barycenter, but the coupling among the population is given by the responsibility. since, as I told, if we don't know the MK, we cannot compute the co-responsibility. So at the end, so the problem, is implicit, is not, cannot, so this quantity are implicitly depends on the responsibility. This is the crucial point. Okay, if you want to make more questions, please no. stop me in any moment. So at the end we get this multi-population mean-field games, where so this is the first equation are classical, since quadratic, since the cost is quadratic with the quadratic interaction cost, interaction potential, the Fokker-Planck equation, but this is an additional variable since the weights of the in which each component enter in the total mass depends on the responsibility, and the responsibility are not known. So for this particular, so this is not, as I told, not the classical multi-population mean-field games. And then these components are unknown, so we depends on the responsibility. Since this is a very particular model in which the Hamiltonian is quadratic, also the cost is quadratic, we can explicitly write the solution in terms of Gaussian distribution. This is the explicit expression. Okay, the weights also we will. So the problem is still in the weights. In any case, the alpha k, mu k, sigma k are unknown, are obtained only when we solve the problem in some way or give explicit formula numerically. And so when solving the problem, we can compute the responsibility. If we compute this responsibility, we can compute the parameter, so we have the solution of the problem. So even if the solution in some ways is given by convex combination of this Gaussian function, we cannot compute explicitly the parameter until we solve the system. Okay, this is the theoretical result in this case, which says in some sense that this model is correct, since if we have a solution of the mean field game system in the previous form, so we are able to find, for simplicity, I'm taking the viscosity equal to 1, otherwise this is only a constant. If we have a solution of the mean field game system, then we get a critical point of the continuous version of a log Lyapunov function, so where the responsibility are exactly given by this formula. So is any solution of the mean field game system gives the coefficient, so the corresponding coefficient which maximizes the log Lyapunov function. And conversely, if we have a local maximum point of the log Lyapunov function, then the corresponding parameter give us a solution on the mean field game system. So there is a complete relation between a solution on the mean field game system, at least in this Gaussian case, and critical point of the log Lyapunov functional. Okay, the idea is starting from this simple model, which is also to understand, one start from the simple model to understand if the theory can be is correct. Starting from the simple model, we can generalize in different directions. For example, it's better to consider a bounded domain, since in general the dataset is restricted to a bounded region of the space. So we consider a general mean field game model similar to the previous one, but with a boundary Neumann boundary condition. So again, this is a multi-population mean field game models with this additional unknown given by the weights and the normalization condition. We can prove that by fixed point that this system admits at least one solution. Uniqueness obviously is not possible. It's not since in general we know that the log Lyapunov maximum function admits several critical points, so it's not possible to have uniqueness in any case. We can generalize, for example, instead of consider quadratic Hamiltonian, we can take more general Hamiltonian, also more general coupling cost, which can be depend on the mean and the covariance, so also more general coupling cost, for example, Kullback-Leiber divergence, in this typical classical Kullback-Leiber divergence. With appropriate assumption, we can prove that the previous QT system admits at least one solution, Okay, now it's clear it's impossible to solve explicitly in the previous multiple action mean field game system. So we introduce a mean field game version of the expectation maximization algorithm. We start from a random initialization of the algorithm for the weights and also for the distribution. Usually we take uniform distribution at the beginning. In the expectation step, we compute the responsibility, say step n, we compute the responsibility, and then in the maximization step, we solve k decoupled mean field game system, since when we give, we know the responsibility. Now, the system for each component decouple, and so we can solve in parallel. Here, this is for the Gaussian Kessmann simplicity. And so we iterate until we get convergence. So this is a Gaussian Kennan one-dimensional, in the one-dimensional case. Some test example to show the method. These are in one dimension. Clearly, so to solve the mean field game system is costly. It's not easy to have dimension. So the problem of dimension is not easy to solve. So here the thin line is the initial distribution of the data point. In this case, the distribution, the data point is made by three blocks, say. And this is the corresponding mixture, corresponding approximation, the convex combination of the probability density function for one k equal one, so only for one component, two component, and three component. So we solve the mean field games with three population. In any case, since the solution of the mean field game system is a second order system, there is a regularizing effect. You can see that the solution of the mean field game system is regular, so it's a regular approximation of the of this stepwise density function. This is the same problem, similar problem, which is oscillating data set. And you can see the solution with respectively 2, 3, and 4. Again, it is a good approximation, but clearly a regular approximation of this oscillating data set. And this is a two-dimensional example. So color quantization for black and white images. For color images is more difficult, since for color images, each point you need to specify three channels, red, green, and blue. Red, okay, three channels. So the problem is six-dimensional for color imaging. For black and white, is two-dimensional. So this is a picture of the puppy of Simone Cacace, and we represent this picture in this way. So in the image is the grayscale distribution of this image. So in the x-axis we had 255 level of gray. So 0 is white, 1 is black, in the intermediate gray level between black, white, and black. And for each level of gray, we count the number of pixels in the images that have the corresponding color, or gray color. So, for example, in the picture, there are no white and black pixels. So, the number of the pixels in white and black is equal to 0. Most of the pictures are in this intermediate gray level. So now we have this grayscale distribution of the picture, and we found a representation by solving the mean field game system. This is a with two components. When we have this representation, these are the convex combination of the two density, probability density function. We compute the corresponding barycenter of these two distribution, and we assign a point in the picture to the gray, to the barycenter, to the gray level corresponding to the barycenter of the distribution for which the responsibility is maximal. For example, say if this point, the responsibility is generated, this point is bigger for this component, for the second component on the right, then we assign to the pixel the color of the barycenter of this component. And so the corresponding image is in two gray level color, and we get these images. If we increase the number of components, we increase the number of the, so we have now three color corresponding to the three barycenter, to the three mean value of the distribution, and for five color, okay, we have a better representation. So this problem is still one dimensional, sorry, I said before two dimensional. This is a two-dimensional example. Instead, is a mouse dataset, as I thought it is a classical test example for this type of algorithm. So the dataset is given in such a way that you can recognize if the point has been generated by one of the three, which, to which one of the cluster has generated the point. And given the data point, we subdivide the domain in cell, and we count for each cell the number of the point which are in the corresponding cell. So we are able to, and we have this distribution, so it just a sort of combination of Dirac function. So for each cell we compute the number of the point, data point which are in the corresponding cell. This is the distribution very regular. We compute by solving the mean field game the corresponding approximation of the distribution, and using the responsibility as before, so the probability that a point has been generated from one of these two components, we can get the following clusterization. So three clusters, red, blue, and green. If you see there is an interface where the point can be generated from one of the two clusters. The problem contains also some white noise. These are the squares, so just a perturbation of the image. The red colors for all the rest of the points, but clearly, so all this so it's not interesting. There is no point in the corresponding area. So these are the three clusters we get. So essentially, it's a good approximation of the problem. Okay, this was for a continuous random variable. So for a random variable, taking value in some Euclidean space RD. Now we consider a similar approach when the random variable is discrete. So takes only a finite number of values, say capital S value. In particular, we can two values which correspond to the Bernoulli random variable. And as before, we have some data set. We want to find the representation of the data set by means of a convex combination of parameterized density function. Okay, for example, if the random variable takes only two values, we use Bernoulli distribution with the okay the parameter is given that by the corresponding Bernoulli parameter. And now we can write in a very similar way an mean field game system. So the first now is less usual to so this is a finite state stationary mean field game system. The first one is an Hamilton-Jacobi equation, ergodic Hamilton-Jacobi equations. This is the ergodic value, the ergodic value function constant. It's written in this explicit format with a minimum. When we compute the minimum, we get this transition probability matrix. So taking the matrix which realizes the minimum in the first line, we have the corresponding Fokker-Planck equation, exactly the matrix PK is the matrix which realizes the minimum normalization condition, and also the weights given by this expression. Here again, the gamma k is the responsibility, so the probability that a point has been generated by a given class. F is the coupling cost, also this depends on the choice of F, in some sense is the fundamental point. This term, epsilon log P, is an entropic regularization, which in practice avoided all the mass of the Bernoulli or the density function. The density function goes in on the, either in the state zero or state one. So this term penalizes the concentration of a mass in one of these two states, or the S two states in the case of the Bernoulli random variable, S states in the case of the categorical random variable. This is, in some sense, the same role of the second order term for the continuous mean field game system, is a regularizing effect. Okay, in this case, we take yes.
Sorry, can I ask a quick question? Yes. Sorry for the interruption. In this part, so the matrix P is interpreted as a probability distribution over, it's not a transition matrix.
It's a density of probability.
It's a density of agents. Okay.
Pi is the distribution, so the distribution of the edge. Capital Pij is the probability transition from the state I to the state J.
Okay. And so you penalize the entropic regularization is using the transition matrix. Yes. Okay, so you want to preserve transitions. I see.
This was okay. The idea, the entropic regularization was the idea was in an old paper by one of the first papers on mean field game system by Diogo Gomes and co-authors.
Okay.
They studied this type of system and they added this term to regularize the problem. And also used by other authors, also Francisco Silva in some recent paper. Okay, so in this case we have a single component, so our random variable will generate this sample, this data set as a single component. But in general can have D component, this is important. So in the general case, so each component can represent some characteristic of the data set. Each component is a categorical random variable taking, or say a binomial random variable taking two values. In this case, we have this system, for this is a hard to read in this way, but what I want to say is for a Bernoulli mixture model, we have a two-stay K population mean field game system for each component. So each component of the state space, there is an associated corresponding mean field game system. And so as I show in the next example, can be a big system. So this is the application. Also, this one is a classical data set available on the web to test this kind of algorithms. These are the digits between 0 and 9 written by alumni of the primary school in the United States. So you can see the digits are very deep. So for example, this represents a 7. It's hard to guess that this is a 7. So you have this big data set composed of 60,000 images of digits from 0 to 9. Each digit is composed by 28 times 28 pixels of black and white, so each pixel can be either black or white. To rewrite the corresponding minfield game system, we instead of consider so this matrix of points, we consider a single vector of with 784 components, each component in 0 and 1. Okay, it's also important that the digits, the dataset, contain also the information about the corresponding numbers. So at the end, we can test if the clusterization is correct. This is included in the dataset. So we applied the previous system. So we applied this system with D equals 784. In K is D is, and S equal to 2, since we have only two states, black and white. So we use Bernoulli distribution, S is equal to 2, but with 70 number of components. So some tests, some example. You can see here we have only two numbers, digit 1 and 3. Since 1 and 3 are different, we can clusterize the corresponding data set rather well. So there is a small error which corresponds to this small quantity here and here. But this is the corresponding random variable, convex combination of the two random variables. So it is sort of representation of the mean representation of the data set. This is for two digits which are similar, so 3 and 5 are similar, and so you can see that the clusterization is not so good as before, so there are part of the number not well clusterized, but this is also for other algorithms, not only for our algorithm. And this is another test for corresponding to even digits. So there is some problem with the digit 6 is digit 2 and digit 6 are so are confused. So that some of the are not correct clusterized, but in general, so we can get a good clusterization. Okay, this was the, I'm going out of time, sorry, I'll try to conclude in a few minutes. This was for the soft clustering. Now I will want to describe another minfield game system for hard clustering. That is the same, we have a big data set that we want to subdivide in class. To get the corresponding system for that class, we follow an idea which is classical also in classical algorithms for cluster analysis. So it is known that the K-means model is the limit of a Gaussian mixture model when the variance, the covariance matrix goes to zero. So if this is well known also in the book, the Bill's book I told before. So we follow a similar idea. We send the parameter epsilon over sigma squared to zero, with epsilon sigma to zero with this relation. We pass to the limit and we get FS order midfield game system. In this system, you cannot see anymore the Fokker-Planck equation since the density degenerates to Dirac function in the body center. So it is not, in any case, so it is not useful to write here. So the corresponding system is a first-order system of Hamilton-Jacobi equation, where the first equation is classical Econ equation. So the first two equations essentially gives the distance from the barycenter mu k. Mu k is the computed as a barycenter of this set, capital S k, which are, okay, the cluster. These are the cluster. The cluster are given, so a point x belongs to the cluster k, if the distance essentially of x from the barycenter, recall this represents the distance from uk, is minimal among the distance from the other barycenter. The coupling among all these systems here is in the cluster. Also in this case, we can write the continuous version of the K-means functional, and it is possible to show that the solution of the previous Hamilton-Jacobi system corresponds to critical point of the continuous version of the K-means functional with the correspondence between the cluster, the set capital SK, which are defined here. We're going to use also in this case a mean-free-game version of the Lloyd algorithm. We start from an initial guess of the body center. We saw in the expectation we solve this Hamilton-Jacobi equation, which is uncoupled. We found the corresponding clusters and we update the body center. This is exactly the continuous version of the mean field game of the Lloyd algorithm. I want to recall a nice interpretation of the K-means functional, also in the, so it is well known. The K-means functional, the K-means problem is connected with this Voronoi region. If you take a region, if you take some point in this region, you can define, you assign to each, so to each region, the point which minimizes the distance from the corresponding point. So this area contains all the points in the region for which the distance from this point is minimal. In this way, you get what is called a Voronoi tessellation of the domain. The Voronoi tessellation depends on the distance. If you change the distance, you get another another tessellation. What is interesting, it is this particular family of tessellation, which are called centroidal Voronoi tessellation. In centroidal Voronoi tessellation, the generator, so the point which generated this tessellation, correspond to body center of the corresponding region. So are tessellation in which the generator, so the point for which we minimize the distance, are also the barycenter of the region. And you can see that the tessellation is much more regular than in the previous case. Okay, this is okay. We test our algorithm to find tessellation, centroidal Voronoi tessellation of this domain. These are two, as I told, the maximal point of the minimum point of the K-means function are not unique. So we can get, starting from different initialization, we get different tessellation of the domain. The red point are so the evolution of the barycenter during the iteration of the algorithm. Now we can generalize the same problem. This problem is more interesting since for the quadratic distance is more or less known. We can consider an arbitrary distance, so a general convex metric, and the corresponding centroidal Voronoi tessellation for this general convex metric. For this metric, we know that to each distance with this type of convex metric, we can associate a corresponding convex positive homogeneous Hamiltonian, and so we can consider the corresponding mean field game system, which is given now by, instead of the diagonal equation, we have this more general Hamiltonian. The other, so the bycenter now are, we don't have an explicit formula for the barycenter, but we have to solve this minimization problem. And so we apply a tessellation for this, we consider this Chebyshev distance, which is given by the minimum of the component of the distance, and these are two tessellation, centroidal Voronoi tessellation. Yeah, in the case, so in the second case, so we use a better triangulation of the domain. Okay, conclusion. So I presented these two algorithms, both hard for hard and soft clustering, and they are essentially an infinite dimensional version of the classical middles in finite dimensional optimization theory. The advantage of using this PD algorithm is set for the PD theory, you can infer some new property, for example, regularity of the solution can give additional property, for example, on the interface of the cluster or other property also about the clusterization. Also, you can consider different Hamiltonian, different coupling costs. So you have more general, so several possible modifications of this algorithm. So, okay, you can generate different directions. What I think it is interesting is that, as I told, there are several algorithms in unsupervised machine learning, also for cluster analysis, also for other problems in unsupervised machine learning. And it could be interesting to find, to understand. In supervised machine learning, it's well known that there is a strict relation between machine learning and optimal control theory. In this case, instead, in unsupervised machine learning, the relation between mean field gains, optimal control problem, algorithm and cluster analysis, or other different problems, has not been much explored up to now. So I think there is space for the study of other algorithms. So these are the paper that where we present this theory for the Gaussian, for the continuous problem, the discrete one, and the algorithm for the cluster analysis, for the R cluster. Thank you very much for the attention.
Thank you very much for the nice talk. Are there any questions or comments? If you want, you can raise your hand or, yes, Thanos.
Thank you very much for the presentation, Fabio. It was super interesting and clear and nice, step by step. My question would be like, if you include common noise, is there any meaning in including common noise in the mean field game system? Could you give some interpretation or like translate it into something different?
It's different to answer to. Since in this case, I don't know, for data points, a common noise what would mean? Well, I have to say that I'm not an expert of this more general model, including common noise, but at this level, I cannot say. So it's some correlation among the points of the data set could be interpreted as a common noise. So in this model, each data point is completely unrelated to other points. So also this was one of the criticisms to this model. If you have, you can still see my presentation.
For me, it's
now, yes.
Before it was
I will try to, okay, I stop, I share again. So, okay, let me share again the presentation. Okay, now you can see the presentation?
Yes.
Okay, yes. If you see this model, in some sense, the model is not particularly accurate since if you have a black point, there is a high probability that a point close to the black point is again black. So instead, if you have a white point with other several points close to this point, there is a high probability that point close to the white point are white. So in this model, there is no correlation between points. So since we consider each component independent from the other, so probably a common noise could be interpreted as a correlation between the fact that two points have other black point close to the point. I don't this could be interesting since from this point this is in general this model are not very accurate since include this additional parameter in any case increases the complexity of the model. But it could be interesting to consider. I don't know if you see Thanos another, you are more expert than me of this type. If you can see.
For me, Some I think it was 2 years ago that I watched a presentation from Lacan, Lacun Lacan, he described his energy methods that he was using for different things, and he was showing pictures that he placed some like he removed a part of the picture and it was kind of white or like he had a patch on the image, and then he was giving that to the algorithm to train it using some noise. And then at that point, and he was also trying to recreate some space with the energy methods that there would be valleys and mountains, and he would try to cross the region, like finding the valleys in the region to recreate the data set. When he was recreating the dataset, and I was thinking at that point that maybe like common noise could have this effect as well, but this is something I haven't investigated, like I haven't thought about. But I don't know, the method or the energy method that he was presenting, like I thought that it could be some connections.
If you will send me the references to this
yes,
work.
Yes, I will contact you with an email. And there is another interesting interpretation clustering about meaningful control version where the populations are connected. I will send you this as well. This is very interesting to see. I think that Mathieu knows the guy I'm talking about.
No, I don't. Which is the name?
He's Chinese, so I think that even if I say his name, like it's going to be wrong. But I think he's Xiao Li. He was student of come on, of E, Vainan E. Now he's in Singapore. I think he was in Chicago last year.
We can send you the references.
Yes.
I think
you
know
him. I think you know him. Not you know. You know.
Okay. Send me your reference.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Any other questions or? I had just one clarification question very quickly. In the last example you have shown, the triangulation is used only for the numerical PD resolution, right? It is not, the tessellation is the colors, I mean, given by the colors, and the triangulation is just used for the numerical solution of the PD.
Yes, exactly. Yeah. To have a domain which are not necessarily square, but also more general domain. Okay, so also to catch better the interface, if you consider a regular grid, it's difficult to catch the interface between the clusters. Using a triangulation problem is better. I have to say I'm not really an expert of this type of numerical computer, but this at least was the motivation that Adriano Festa gave to me to use this type of
thing. Okay. Well, thank you again for the very nice talk.
Thanks.
And well, thank you, everyone.